Before taking up the last topic, namely classification of triangulated compact surfaces, let me make a few general remarks on triangulation in particular. A triangulation of a manifold has necessarily more combinatorial structure, more combinatory information on the manifold. We have made a small beginning of the study of these properties. Before, besides theoretical importance, it provides a very good effective tool in the study of topological properties of manifolds. For example, I have told you, now you can actually, you know, computerize the study of topology through simplicial complexes. The fundamental classical questions here are, can every topological manifold be triangulated? If you cannot do that, you put, okay, differentiable manifolds can be triangulated. So like this, these are some questions there. Given, next question, given two triangulations K1 and K2 of a topological manifold, is K1 combinatorially equivalent to K2? By which, recall, we mean that there are subdivisions K1 prime of K1 and K2 prime of K2 such that the two subdivisions are isomorphic. That is, you know, combinatorial equivalence. Does every triangulated manifold carry a smooth structure? So these are the few standard questions. Let us see how far in literature we know about these questions. From the classification of one-dimensional manifolds, it easily follows that every one-dimensional manifold is triangulable because the connected components are just open interval, closed interval, half closed interval, or the circle. So these you can triangulate. So everything can be triangulated. It can also be proved that each one-dimensional manifold, topological manifold, has a unique smooth structure. Okay. If you go through the proof of the classification, at several stages, at some of the stages, not several, you will have to improve homeomorphism to diffeomorphism. So that requires a little more difficult, a little more work, that's all. A classical result due to Rado, this way back in 1924, almost more than a century, says that all manifolds, okay, two-dimensional manifolds are triangulable. Though this proof is within our limitations, due to lack of time, we shall skip it. Okay. The triangulativity of all three-dimensional manifolds is a deeper result due to Moyes, who also proved that any two triangulations, K1, K2, of the same three manifold are combinatorially equivalent. Okay, that means what? I have just told you that there are subdivisions KIs of KI such that K1 prime and K2 prime are isomorphic. By the way, this reference is for his book. His actual papers, the proof, etc., have appeared much before. A theorem due to Cairns in 1935, says that every smooth manifold is triangulable. There is an improved version of this one in Whitehead 1940, okay, which gives a neater proof and a stronger result. So every smooth manifold is triangulable, okay, in dimension greater than or equal to 4. Okay, 1, 2, 3, we know. 1 is easy, 2 is Rado, 3 is Moyes. But bigger than or equal to 4, there are triangulable manifolds which do not admit any smooth structure. Every smooth manifold is triangulable is Kanner's result. But the other way around, there are manifolds which cannot admit smooth structure. The first example came in 1960, that was due to Carver, and that was in dimension 10, which was soon improved to dimension 8 by Eales and Kuiper. Then Siebenmann has constructed an example of a 5-dimensional manifold which cannot be triangulated. With these classical results, we may safely say that the above three questions have been answered satisfactorily. Why I am not talking about dimension 4? Dimension 4 is much more crazy. Craziest dimension amongst all of them. Okay, so I will not speak about it here. These results are quite hard and beyond the scope of this experiment. So let us make a small beginning today of compact surfaces. It won't be finished now, nor reverse. Just lay down some plan of action. First of all, I will use the word surface just to mean compact two-dimensional connected topological manifold without boundary. So I will not keep on saying all this, I will just say surface. Okay, this is just for a temporary notation, temporary terminology, just for another 2-3 lectures like this, that's all. Okay, next we fix a triangulation on a connected compact surface, just like that, on a surface. Okay, we then appeal to our theorem wherein we constructed a convex triangulated polygon and a surjective morphism from quotient map actually from the polygon to X, right? So that is a representation of X as a quotient of a convex polygon P with two n sides. And what is the identification? Identifications are coming only from the boundary sides, the boundary, you know, edges are paired up, and then the identification is taken by homeomorphism from one of them to another one in the pair by a linear homeomorphism. Okay, and we identify that the quotient space is precisely our K with a triangulation, appropriate triangulation. Okay, so this process can be completely described now purely combinatorially, as if we don't have any topology there at all. What do we do? A surface now will be described by this quotient map. Okay, so what is this? The top thing is a convex polyhedron. Triangulated convex polyhedron. And where is the identification? You take a pairs of, you know, it is a, first of all, it has two even dimensional polygon pairs, and then identify linear isomorphism. Linear isomorphism is just edge going to edge, either one way or the other way. There are only two isomorphisms there. Endpoint going to endpoint, linear isomorphism of one interval, closer interval to another closer interval. Okay, there are only two possibilities. So let us agree once and for all that we shall trace the boundary of any convex polygon in the anti-clockwise direction. Okay, like we trace a circle in two different ways, anti-clockwise and clockwise. Let's fix for once for all anti-clockwise direction. We are free to start from any vertex. That we don't fix. Okay, you can start from any vertex, keep going around. So what are we going to do? We then label the edges by letters A, B, C, and so on. Edges are labeled now, A, B, C. Okay, as soon as we meet an edge which is being identified with the edge that we have already labeled, we shall not use another letter. We shall use the same letter. Suppose I have started A, B, and the next one is identified with A. Then I won't call it C. I will call it A. But now I have another stronger convention. In the orientation that we are taking, namely following the anti-clockwise, whether this edge, the third edge, is identified with the given edge in the same orientation or not, accordingly, I will call it A or A inverse. A inverse, if the orientation is reversed. Now, the arrow is on the other side. We are going from anti-clockwise, but the arrow on the edge is clockwise. Okay, the arrow will be playing depending upon now how we started with A positive. There was nothing starting with A. So you have put an arrow in the anti-clockwise direction. B, there's new one, anti-clockwise. The next one is repeated, but the edge name as well as the orientation on that will depend upon how it is identified and with what it is identified. Okay? Is that clear how we are going to label them? All right, as soon as we meet an edge which is being identified with an edge which has already been labeled, we shall use the same letter to label this new edge also. That's first thing. The second thing is we have to take care of another aspect, namely whether the identification is orientation preserving or orientation reversing. To indicate an edge with reversed orientation, we shall use labelings A inverse, B inverse, etc. Of course, we stop as soon as we have arrived back where we started. Since the starting point is arbitrary, what this process yields is that the surface X is completely determined by the cyclic sequence. Suppose I start at a point, one point, you start at another point. So whatever from my point to your point in the beginning, for you, that part will occur at the end. Instead of A, B, C, D, you may get B, C, D, A. So up to cyclic permutation, okay, the convex polygon and its quotient is completely determined by this sequence. Just you have to try to manage sequence. As soon as you give a sequence, the length of sequence must be even. That's all. Immediately, it defines a surface. Okay? A compact, connected, two-dimensional manifold without boundary. So it's described by a sequence of length 2L. The only condition is you can't have just A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H. That kind of sequence is not allowed. Each letter should occur twice, exactly twice. The sign of the letter, whether A or A inverse, that is left to you. Okay? There is no point in writing both A inverse. Then you can write them as both A. It's the same thing, right? So one is A and one is A inverse, or both of them have AA. So this is the nature of sequence. as soon as I have such sequence, it defines a surface. Okay, so cyclic sequence which looks like A1 epsilon 1, A2 epsilon, An epsilon 1, where epsilon 1s are nothing but plus minus 1. But I will write A raised to 1. A, I will just write A1. When it's inverse, I will write A1 inverse. Okay. So note that in this sequence, each letter AI occurs precisely twice. In particular, this N is even. Okay. For the simplicity of notation, an edge A plus occurring with a plus sign, we drop this sign and simply write it as A. A sequence such as 41, if I keep calling this 41, sequence 41, okay, is called canonical polygon. Just to contrast it with an arbitrary polygon. Okay, a canonical polygon means polygon sides two end. The interior is triangulated, the whole thing is triangulated, all this. Okay, we shall use bold face capitals A, comma B, etc., to denote a part of the sequence. Okay, such as 41. Suppose you have one sequence here, a part of it I won't want to write A, B, C, D, capital A followed by some F, G, F inverse, G inverse, like this. This part A is some sequence of them. Okay, for that kind of reason, I will club them together. This A itself may consist of 5 letters, B consists of 10 letters, and so on. Doesn't matter. All right. For N greater equal to 4, okay, we can represent a canonical polygon, the sequence, by actually a regular convex polygon. Okay, 3 also we can do, but 3 doesn't occur in our case. The minimum is 4. If there is a 2 or 0, where is a polygon you can draw? Okay, so I did discuss that case first, later on. So for n greater than equal to 4, actual convex polygon you can write. Okay, regular convex polygon P in R2 with n sides, with its sides appropriately labeled. Observe that we allow the exceptional case n equal to 2 also, we have to allow. In this case, we do not get a convex polygon. So what do? We get a convex set. Namely, now you go round shape. Namely, you will take a disk. Okay, on that disk, you can divide the boundary into two semicircular arcs. Okay, and then label them as AA or AA inverse over. Okay, so that is the case 2, n equal to 2. Okay, of course, n equal to 0 doesn't occur because it has to be non-empty convex polygon. However, in case, n equal to 2, we take P to be the unit disk, with its boundary being divided into two edges, the sequence itself is being AA inverse or AA. Okay, so there are only two cases when n equal to 2. You consider this map, from the unit disk in the XZ plane, X0Z I have written, on to the unit sphere in R3. This X coordinate is this one, Y coordinate is this one, Z coordinate is as it is. Okay, this map proves that the surface represented by the sequence A inverse, two edges being labeled from bottom to top, like this, A inverse. What is the space? What is the space, quotient space, when you identification is like this? These two edges are being identified like that from this. So that is the picture, that is the map I am giving you. So how does it do? This is your disk, unit disk in the XZ plane. Look at any of these chords as you move parallel to the X axis up. Okay, from here it's minus 1 to plus 1. Here it will be 1 by square root, what is it? Square root of 1 minus r square, right? Minus square root of 1 minus r square is plus square root of 1 minus r square. And finally, it will be, this will be 0. So as it moving this, this edge will be mapped to the corresponding circle here. The circle obtained by cutting the surface, cutting this two sphere by the plane xy, z equal to z, whatever. Z equal to z naught, as z keeps moving. Okay, the xy plane. So they go like that. So what you get is this quotient wherein edge from here to here is identified with edge from here to here. Okay, just the x coordinate being the go to x equal to minus x. It's a linear map. All right. So that is one case. The other case, what is the other case? The other case is when this edge is identified with that edge in the same direction. So that is same thing as antipodal action. Every point here will be identified with that point. When you antipodal action on the disk, only on the boundary, we know that this is a projective space dimension 2. Okay, this also we have known. Recall that a projective space P2 is the quotient of S2 by the antipodal action. But you don't need the whole of S2. You can take only the upper half hemisphere. Then the identification is only on the equator. So that can be identified precisely as if a flat disk and the boundary. Okay, and the sequence will be now AA. So AA represents projective space. AA inverse represents sphere. Okay, so we have started classification. In the simplest case, we have finished the classification. Okay, now let us concentrate on n greater than or equal to 4 only. Okay, so I will have this some kind of operation here now and notation. We can add two canonical polygons. So one polygon is A. A is a sequence, remember that, of length 2 and so on. Another is B. B is another sequence of length 2. By merely concatenating the corresponding two sequences, AB. So it will be of length 2n plus 2m. Okay. Of course, this operation is commutative in the restricted sense. Namely, because of the what? Cyclic order. See, a sequence is taken up to cyclic order. Therefore, AB is the same thing as BA. Okay. Only thing is, once you write AB, you can't cut it in some other place and change over. That can be a problem. Every time you change, you have to do only cyclic order. Okay, suppose A, I write it as A1, A2. Then A1, A2B is not equal to A2, A1B. That kind of commutativity is not there. A1, A2B will be equal to B, A1, A2 equal to what? You keep circulating like this, okay? So first B, A1, A2, and then A2, B, A1, and so on. So that kind of cyclic permutation is allowed of each letters. Okay? So this kind of adding is actually, in this case, comes from a geometric operation on manifold connected called connected sum. So here we shall take this as definition of connected sum. Connected sum of the surface A with surface B. Okay, in a simple geometric terms, it means that you make a hole by removing a small disk in one of them and another small disk from the other one. Okay, then the two resulting circles, you identify them. to get a different surface. So that is called a larger surface, perhaps. It's called connected zone. Okay. So we don't need to go deeper into that. Just take this as the definition of connected. So I'll give you an example. Okay. So here is my A. I don't know how many. I have drawn three edges here. Maybe there are more. Here also three edges, and there are more. Dot, dot, dot. So put all the A here, then follow by all the B here. Over. So that will be larger convex polygon. Okay, 2n gone plus a 2m gone equals 2m plus n gone. Okay, several canonical polygons may define the same surface up to homeomorphism. What we have so far said is, from canonical polygons, the set of canonical polygons, to the triangulated manifold, two-dimensional manifold, there is surjection. Is it injective? No. In what sense? Whatever sense. That is the meaning of this. Namely, several of them may define the same surface. And that is why there is a problem. I mean, we have to do otherwise. The problem was over. It would have gone on. Okay. Our next step is to make a list which should include all possible topological types as well as have no redundancy. Our list should not have A and A prime are the same surfaces and so on. The list must be distinct. If A is A1, A2, A3, or 1, 2, 3, 4, the 3, whatever represents 4, they must be topologically different. That is the meaning of no redundancy. Okay, and it should be exhaustive. Somebody later on make, oh, this surface is left out from here. That should not happen. Once you have achieved that, the classification is over. Okay, so first we propose a list, and then we say, okay, this is the list. That means we have to prove it. Okay, right? But let us now illustrate the point that two different canonical polygons, different means what now? Cyclically different. A, B, C, D, let us take this sequence. B, A, C, A, B, A, D, B, C, D, A, B, C, D, A. These two are the same because cyclically they are the same. That is not the point. Even cyclically different ones may define the same surface. Let us examine that, okay? So consider surface given by the sequence AB, A inverse, B inverse. Just to recall, this is a familiar one to you, namely, what you have a rectangle, the side A, and its opposite side are identified with the orientations coming in the same direction. The A, B, and B inverse are identified with the opposite orientation. A, so A, B inverse. Okay. See, when you follow A, B, when you keep following that, the A, B, okay, A, B, A is coming, not A inverse. So it's A. So when you have do that, if you remember A, B, A inverse, B inverse was the torus. A, B inverse was the Klein bottle. Okay. So we have seen that this represents Klein bottle. Mark the diagonal of the square piece. You may do it on your own right now. Take a rectangle, your piece, mark ABCD, ABA inverse, B inverse, and take the diagonal piece, okay, diagonal, draw a diagonal with a thick arrow, and label it as C, okay, and cut the square along this arrow as shown in figure 32 here. AB, AB, see, B is in the opposite direction. So A B inverse, right? So now I am drawing this diagonal from the beginning of A to the beginning of other A. So that is a key, okay? Or you could have done it from end of A to the end of A. Okay, that is what you have to remember. So this will be going to be an extra edge. Now you cut it. Cut here. The upper triangle, you bring it down and twist it. I mean, flip it. So that this arrow A gets in the same line, aligned with this arrow at the bottom. So A and A are identified, right? You have to identify them. So this upper part of the triangle is identified here after bringing it bottom. Now the figure doesn't look like a rectangle, but it has four sides. So you can easily deform, easily, you know, represent it by a rectangle like this one. Okay, so this is C, that is B, and then again B, and then C. So it is C, B, C, C, B, B, C, or B, B, C, C. No problem. Right? Remember, now if I just stop here, cut it here, it is BB. What is BB? BB is a projective space. P2. Similarly, CC is a projective space, P2. So you can think of this as the sum of two projective spaces, the connected sum of two projective spaces. The point is that it is the same Klein bottle. It is the same surface is seen. Why? Because wherever I cut, I am identifying C and C. See, that's why precisely I have to draw this one on both sides, the same arrow, so that you should not bungle the arrow. The same arrow I have to take. Okay, this arrow has become like this here. This has become straightened here. Okay, so C followed by C. Okay, therefore, what we have just now proved by this method is that the Klein bottle is homeomorphic to the connected sum of P2 with itself. Okay, so this is what is going to be cut and paste technique. This will be heavily used in the classification here. So these two are different, obviously. See, A, B inverse. There is no inverse at all here. So B, 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 C, C. These two sequences are different, but they define the same what? Same surface. This one we are familiar, we call it a Klein bottle. This doesn't look like familiar, but now we have just introduced. It is P2 connected some P2. But the surface is the same. Therefore, so these two objects are homeomorphic. All right. Let us stop here today. So tomorrow we will actually start the classification proper. Thank you.